Please join me in prayer. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace be yours this day from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. The text for this morning's meditation comes to us from our epistle lesson in Ephesians chapter 6. December 1944 was the beginning of the bloodiest battle of World War II. Hundreds of thousands of soldiers lost their lives on both sides of the battlefield. As various documented resources would have it, the Germans were hoping to make their final push into the Allied lines. They're looking for the right opportunity to attack, the right spot. Most people thought that the war had taken the turn, that it was near the end. But the Germans were looking for one more opportunity to gather their resources, to go through the line, isolate some of the Allied forces, and perhaps at least even up the battle. As Rocky Blunt put it, who was in the infantry for the United States Army, he said this was a difficult time for the Allied forces because they weren't necessarily prepared for the battle. Unfortunately, it grew extremely cold, and they didn't have the resources needed to battle the cold. In fact, they lost just as many men to the weather as they did to the opposing soldiers. He remembered going through some of the burned-up buildings, looking for anything he could to keep warm. He found some drapes, and he tore them off the wall, and he wrapped his feet in them, and found newspapers, and stuffed them inside the boots just so he could try and keep warm. Finally, after much time, they were able to hold fast. The Germans came in, they nearly broke the lines, they pushed the lines back so it would bend and bulge, and eventually they held. This was, of course, the Battle of the Bulge. And when this was over, pretty much the Allied forces had won the war. Still a lot of fighting, still a lot of battles, but there weren't many resources for the Germans after this point. When the fighting was tossed, the grave stood firm. I remember growing up hoping that I would get my way. Whenever I asked my mother a question, I could usually tell by her response if I had an opportunity. Now, she might say something like, "Well, we'll see," or perhaps my request. But every once in a while, she would say, "Well, I think your dad has other plans." I knew what that meant. Every once in a while, I could coax my father and change his mind. But if I was really persistent, I would get that look. You know the look that your father's had, the raised eyebrow, kind of the scowl? "I believe you heard my answer." He would stand firm. I knew he wasn't going to budge. I knew there was going to be no bulge. That he would stand firm, and that was his answer. I really think that's the discussion for what we have today. Put on the full armor of God. Now, I don't need to take a moment to talk about all of the armor that God has put for us, because that's such a wonderful job. But for today, I would like to talk about why we have this armor. Did you notice it? Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand. Verse 13, take it up that you may be able to withstand. Stand, then, having done it, stand firm. Verse 14, stand, therefore, with this armor in place. What's the message? When you are in battle, when you are at war, you are to stand. Stand in such a way that your opponent, the person on the other side of the battle, will know that you are not going to budge. You are to stand in such a way that you will come out victorious. You are to stand in such a way that they will know that you are right and that they are wrong. You are to stand against the enemy. But who is the enemy? That's really the ultimate question. Is it your wife or your husband? Is it your neighbor who's pushing the limits in terms of noise curfew? Perhaps it's your mom who won't let you grow up, or your daughter who always has to make it a battle. Perhaps it's your son who just won't listen. Or perhaps it's your father who won't leave you alone. Maybe it's your employee or your employer. Maybe it's your pastor when he sings the wrong words and tune to "This Is the Feast." There are battles everywhere. And we're constantly fighting. But where's the battle? See, Paul's letting us in on a little secret here. The battle isn't against flesh and blood. It's against the power of the evil one. In fact, he's leading up to this at this point. If you follow through the book of Ephesians, you can see in chapter 2, he says that we are in Christ, but we are one. In chapter 4, he says, we are united as the body of Christ. We are one. In chapter 5, he says, husbands and wives, love one another. We are one. And then in chapter 6, he tells husbands and wives to love their children, and for children to love their mothers and their fathers. They are to be one. And slaves and masters, do not go in their own direction, but work toward that common goal. You are to be one. So basically, to summarize it, whatever your vocation, whatever it is that God has called you to do, whatever it is that you are called to be, you are to be one, standing next to the individuals who are in this battle with you, not fighting against one another, but closing the gap so that the evil one cannot penetrate, so that he cannot divide, so that he cannot separate, so that he cannot have his way with us. Some have suggested that the Allied forces leading up to the Battle of the Bulge were a little overconfident. Had a lot of victories. The German army had been retreating. They assumed it was almost over. But they were unprepared. How about you? Are you prepared? See, I really tend to think that we're not. Not that we're not prepared and equipped, but I think too often as Christians, we forget about the battle. Do you think about the battle? How the evil one, on a daily basis, is seeking to devour you. That through the circumstances of your life, whether it's the loneliness, or the depression, or the anger, or the hunger, he's trying to do everything he can to blow through the gap and divide you from the rest of your brothers and sisters in Christ. Do you consider the battle? And how it's not your spouse who's the enemy, but it's the anger. That it's not the church member that you have a problem with, but it's the pride. It's not the employee or the employer that you really have the issue with, it's the stress. It's not the son or the daughter, but it's the impatience that you have a battle with. And it's not the mother or the father that you're struggling with, it's the arrogance. It's the lying. It's the deceitfulness. It is the anger. It's the lust. It's the fill in the blank with whatever it is that the devil is trying to do to get us to break. It is said that the 106th Division is the one that took the brunt of the German forces. Each division was supposed to cover about 5 miles or so, but unfortunately the 106th Division had to cover about 25 miles. That's a lot of gaps. That's a lot of opportunities for the enemy to strike. And it did. But they held the line. It was said that most were either captured or lost their lives. But they held and stood firm. They bulged in a way that they held off the enemy until other resources could come in and support them. That's heroic. Second only to one, Jesus Christ, comes into the midst of battle. And he stands firm. He comes and stands with tax collectors, sinners, but he stands with us. He goes up against the evil one. Turn this stone into bread. He stands hungry. Throw yourself from the temple, but he stands on the word of God and says, no. Go ahead and fall down and worship me and I will give you everything. But he stands on the word of God and worships the Father only. In the midst of all that he is faced with, Jesus stands and he stands strong, even to the point where he has to carry his cross to Golgotha and he suffers and he dies. But on that Sunday, that resurrection day, Jesus will stand. You see, I know that we don't always fight the good fight. But a lot of times we do suffer. We're knocked down. We're pushed back. But what is it that Paul actually says in our text for today? Be strong and stand firm in the Lord and in his strength. Last night we went ice skating. And the goal of ice skating, of course, is to what? Stand. Try to get around that rink. So my daughter is in front of me. It was tough. Took two steps, and guess what happened? Fall. Took two steps, guess what happened? Fall. But did she hit the ice? No. I was there. First thing I seen was good enough to catch her, right? This is how we're able to stand firm. We come wounds from the battle, but he catches us and lifts us up so we can stand firm together. Stand firm with our spouse. Stand firm with our brothers and sisters. Stand firm with our sons and daughters. Stand firm with our church members. So that there is nothing the evil one can throw at us that will divide us. Because we know in Jesus, though we are still fighting, though there are still battles, though there are still losses, we know that as we are fighting, we have already won. So stand firm today. Because the victory is ours. Amen.
Amen.
Gracious Father, we give you thanks for the victory. The victory that you have given us in Jesus, that you have equipped us with the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness, that you have given us the sword of the Spirit and the belt of truth, that we might stand firm in the readiness of the gospel. Bless us as we go from this place, that we might stand firm for you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
This time I write you all to rise and confess the faith with me.